Well, we're now being joined live by all of our campuses, and I get to introduce a special speaker who's here with us this weekend. His name is Robby Gallaty, and he and his wife, Candy, lead a church in Tennessee called Long Hollow Baptist. It's like our kind of church, like we would all love it down there. And he just wrote a book. He's written a bunch of books, but he's got a new one coming out here this week. It's called Here and Now, and it's about living the kingdom of God now, not later. And he's been a big friend to our church. He's been a big friend to my dad. Frankly, he's just a big guy. And when I saw him in person, I was pretty physically intimidated. And when I hear him preach, I'm theologically intimidated. Would you please join me in welcoming Robby Gallaty?
Amen. Thank you, Landon, for the warm welcome. Good to be here. Thank you for having me. My name is Robby Gallaty. I have the most important person in the world with me, my wife, Candy. She doesn't normally get to travel with me, but she's here today. How could you come to Chicago without your wife, right? So Candy's here with me as well. And Pastor James invited me about 6 months ago. He said, man, listen, you have a story that God radically saved you from heroin and cocaine. And he said, I think that's gonna jive with the community and our people are gonna really appreciate what God did with your life. And so what I wanna just share right out the gate, in just a few moments, I'm gonna share my story. And I wanna tell it in such a way that I wanna encourage you to see that if God can change me, then he can change anybody, amen? And so the title of the message today, if you're taking notes, is this. I want to talk to you about the day Jesus came looking for you. I want to talk about the day Jesus came looking for you. Anybody in here have a dad that has the same name as you? Anybody named after your dad? What's your name? Alfonso. Alfonso? Your dad's name's Alfonso. Does he have like a nickname? You have the nickname, okay. So my dad's name's Robert. Anybody else with dad's same name? Okay, so my dad's name's Robert. I'm Robert. I'm Robby, thank God. He's Big Bob, okay? And he's kind of a cool, kind of funny guy, but Big Bob suits him well. But I wanna tell you a story all the way back 2,000 years ago of a man named Bartimaeus whose father's name was Timaeus. Now, in the first century, when you had kids, particularly boys, you had them for two reasons. Now think about this. You had a boy for one reason, to work for the family, obviously, and he would go out and make money and he would bring money into the family. But the second reason is you would have a boy to keep on the family name. So kind of the genealogy of the family you continued on. But if you had a child, get this, who was blind, not only could he not work for the family, what would happen? Audience participation part, by the way, right? What would happen? He would cost the family money, right? And so in the first century, if you were blind, you had to resort to doing something to make money, because what the family would do is they would just kick you out. They would say, listen, we can't afford you, so we're gonna get rid of you. And so what did you do? You begged, okay? And so you took a cup and you found like a well-positioned area of the community, kind of a busy thoroughfare, a street. You kind of planted yourself down there, and the prized possession you had was a cloak. The cloak was everything to you. Why? Because during those Palestinian days when it'd get really hot, what Bartimaeus would do is he'd hold his cloak above his head, and he would shade himself from the sun. But then at night, if you've ever been to Israel, it'd get really cold at night. And so what he would do is he'd take his cup, he would pull it in real close, he would take the jacket, and he would wrap it around himself. Now, I want you to feel the weight of this before we move on. If he loses this cloak, he loses everything. I mean, this is like everything to him. This is his security blanket. This is his protection. This is his clothing. So he loses this, he loses everything. So I want to bring you into the life of Bartimaeus. If you have a Bible, I hope you do. Turn with me to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. And when you get to verse 46, at the church I pastor in Nashville, Tennessee, we like to say word because we know it's the word that changes our lives, right? And so we get into the word until the word gets into us. So when you're there, you can say word.
Word.
Amen. You guys love the word here too, I heard. Amen. The word of the Lord. When they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a large crowd, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, a blind beggar. So there it is. Let me teach you a little Hebrew. Bartimaeus is not really his name. His name is actually Timaeus. But in Hebrew, whenever you see the word bar, B-A-R, in front of a name, it means son of, okay? So Bartimaeus is the son of Timaeus. He was a blind beggar sitting by the roadside. Verse 47. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many warned him to keep quiet, but he was crying out all the more, "Have mercy on me, son of David." Let's pray as we begin. Father, we pray today as we study this passage that although we know this text or maybe even heard this message preached, that the words of the pages will come off and touch our hearts in such a way that we would be changed. God, I know in a group this size, there are some who would say, "I remember the day Jesus came looking for me. I remember the moment that I got saved." And I pray for those even now who would say, "I don't have that time to go back to because it never happened." And God, I pray for everyone in between. And I pray, God, that all of us today would be able to leave this place and say that we came in contact with the living God. And that we would leave this place not saying we heard a great sermon or a good message or even sung great songs together. We would leave this place and say we have been in the presence of a great God. And so, Lord, you be the teacher. We'll be the student. We pull a seat up to your table. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. What I want to show you in this story is, or in this encounter, are three things that are applicable for our life. Three ways that we could take a page from Bartimaeus' book and really apply it to our own life. And here's what I want to show you. Whenever Jesus heals someone physically, he's always doing something spiritually significant, right? So in a sense, we see a blind man physically. But what Jesus is going to show us is that he is spiritually blind as well, just like all of us apart from God, right? You remember the day before you met Christ. You were dead in your trespasses and sins, which you once walked, following the course of this world, the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, gratifying the desires of the flesh, and were by nature children of wrath. So there was a time when you and I were blinded, even if you're a Christian now. But I want to show you three things that happen and really ways we can respond in the way Bartimaeus did. Number one, if you're taking notes, it's this. Understand your situation. We need to understand our situation. Jesus is traveling in the text to Jericho. Anybody ever been to Israel in here? Anybody? It's one of the greatest experiences of your life. Just encourage you if you haven't gone yet. I try to take a tour every year in a group of people. I think it's like a fifth gospel, if you will, to kind of see it for yourself. But if you go to Jericho, you know it's the last stop on the trip up to Jerusalem. So when Jesus is coming down from Galilee, which is the north, he's making his way through Jericho up to Jerusalem. From Jericho to Jerusalem, it's roughly about an 800-foot difference in sea level. So you're going to make this journey straight up the hill. And Jesus comes to Jericho, and that day Bartimaeus is probably just going about his business like any day. I want you to imagine that day. He comes out to his particular spot. He probably has his jacket wrapped around his waist, and he gets to the spot he's going to sit at, right? And so he kind of feels around. He puts his jacket down, kind of like a mat, if you will, and he's going to sit down. And I want you to hear it. He's going to wait for the city to come alive, right? And if we're still enough, you can almost hear the women going to the well with their water jars, right? And you can almost hear the hooves of the cattle walking through town. And you can almost hear the people moving through the market. Well, he hears those things. But this day he notices that this is not a normal day. Why? Because the text says in the distance there's a, look at the text, a great crowd of people with Jesus. So he closes, or he kind of sits down and sets up shop, and he listens and he hears, watch this, not the footsteps of two or three. He hears the footsteps of thousands that day. And he starts to hear through the crowd that this miracle worker, this Messiah, Jesus, is there. And so he's about to take a chance on him, right? I mean, this is a man who is an outcast. He's separated. He's looked over. He's overlooked. He's unclean. By no means is he supposed to be speaking in public, much less yelling in public. But Bartimaeus, and I want you to get this. Don't miss this, Harvest. Bartimaeus is not about to let Jesus Christ walk by his life without at least taking a chance. So what does he do? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And I want to show you what the crowd does. Look what the crowd says. Be quiet. Shut up. We don't have time for you. Now, before we unpack what they say, let's just kind of drill down on what he says, because for a blind man, he's got a lot of understanding of messianic theology, right? Did you catch what he said there? He says two things. He says, Jesus, Son of David. Now, where does he get this from? In the genealogy of Matthew, if you go back to Matthew chapter 1, if you hold your place at Mark, you'll notice that the Messiah, the chosen anointed one of God, has to come through a particular genealogy, right? And verse 6 shows us that Jesse fathered who? King David. David fathered Solomon, who built the temple. And then if you trace it down to verse 16, it says, whose husband of Mary, Joseph, gave birth to Jesus, who's called the what? The Christ, so the Messiah. So here's what Bartimaeus is saying. Number one is, I know exactly who you are, which is important for salvation. Like these two things have to coexist. Like, he knows who Jesus is, but he also knows who he is. Did you catch what he said? Jesus, Son of David, have what? Have mercy on who? On this guy next to me? On my husband? On my wife? No. Who's he say? Me. Did you catch that? It's personal. Now, that word mercy is an interesting word. It's a word filled with theological meaning, but the word mercy basically means, don't do to me what I deserve. He doesn't say, great, give me grace, which he could have, but he says, Jesus, the Messiah, have mercy on me. I know I'm a sinner. I know what I've done. I know where I've been. But I know who you are, and I know what you can do. But the crowd is religious, right? You've been around religious people before? You know, sometimes religious people can cause the most problems in churches, right? You know what I'm saying? I mean, these are the religious folk, right? So, like, he's crying out, like, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And they're like, hey, why don't you be quiet? Don't you see we're on a mission here? I mean, don't you? We're going to Jerusalem to change the world. We definitely have no time for you. And what does he do? He cries out again. Here's what I want you to get. Don't miss this. How many of us would have missed an opportunity to have Jesus stop because we were too worried about our own pride or worried about what people would think of us in the crowd? I want you to get this. Bartimaeus was not worried about what anybody thought about him when it came to calling out to Jesus Christ. He was not about to let Jesus walk by without at least taking a chance. I want to ask you, how many times in a service like this, Or maybe you're watching online, or maybe you're saying, hey, look, I've been in an experience like this where God's really worked in my heart. I felt the presence of God. I sensed the presence of the Holy Spirit. I knew God was kind of calling and wooing me to respond, but I didn't do it because I was too worried about what people would think. I was too worried about how people would look at me. Bartimaeus is not about to let Jesus walk by without, number one, taking a stand. So number one, what he does in this text, write it down. He understands his situation. Number two is, he surrenders his life to Christ. Now, what's interesting about this text is, if you go to verse 49, The text says in verse 49, Jesus does something, and I don't want to gloss over this. Do you see it? Jesus what? Stopped. Did you catch that? Jesus stopped. This is the God who created the world. This is the one who put the stars in place and put the planets in the sky and formed everything by hand and breathed into man, and yet he stops. And I want you to see, God obviously is over all things, but he's never in a rush when a repentant sinner comes back to him. And Bartimaeus cries out. It says Jesus stops and says, call him. So they called the blind man and said to him, have courage, get up, he's calling you. Verse 50, you're not going to want to miss this. Throwing off his cloak, or he threw off his coat, jumped up and came to Jesus. The second thing I want to challenge you from the life of Bartimaeus is not only understand your situation, number two, we need to surrender our life to Christ. Like, we need to completely surrender our life to Christ. Bartimaeus' cloak is significant. Tim Keller, a couple years ago, did some research and found out that in the first century, cloaks were like permits to beg. Did you know this? Like you couldn't just go to a town and set up shop. Even as a blind man to beg, you had to have the particular permit or the color cloak to beg. And so, like, Jerusalem had maybe like a black coat, and Jericho had like a red coat, and Galilee had like a green coat. And so you had to have the cloak to beg. Now, this really makes us understand even fuller. If he loses this coat, not only does he lose his security and his protection, but he loses his life. This is his livelihood. And I want to just paint the scene, and I don't know if it happened this way, but follow me. Bartimaeus cries out to Jesus. The crowd tries to shun him, and he cries again. And so he's in the middle of yelling. Picture the scene here. And they're yelling. They're like, listen, look, we don't have, like, wait, what are you talking about? We're going to, you want this guy? Like, that's what they're saying, right? Like, Jesus, do you know who this guy is, right? Like, you want this guy? And Jesus is like, that's exactly the guy I want. And so they run over. They're like, hey, get up. He's calling you. Now, you have to understand, this man probably hadn't showered in a long time. He's unclean. Doesn't look like he's ready for church, right? I mean, this is a man who's overlooked and looked over. And so he gets up with his cloak. Now, you have to understand, if he loses the cloak in the crowd of thousands that day, he'll never find this thing again. Like, he can't even set this down. And the text doesn't say, like, hey, man, listen, I'm going to go see Jesus. Can you hold this cloak? Doesn't say that, right? Text doesn't even say he takes the cloak and folds it in fourths and puts it. Does the text say that? No. The text doesn't even say he tucks it in the back of his pants. Look what the text says. The text says he gets to his feet, watch this, throwing his cloak aside, he comes to Jesus. I want you to feel the weight of this. What's the cloak in your life that's holding you back from truly going all in for God? What is that coat in your life? I want to give you a couple options here. Maybe it's an addiction in your life. Like what's that persistent, consistent sin in your life where if you're looking at it, you're saying, this is the one thing holding me back from God. Maybe it's a drug addiction. Maybe it's alcoholism. Maybe it's an eating disorder. Something in your life that you say, this is something that I'm trying to go all in, but it's this consistent thing that's kind of plaguing my life. Maybe it's a bad attitude. Maybe it's your pride. Maybe it's arrogance. I want you to just think about this just for a moment. I want you to name it. I want you to attach a name to it. And I want you in just a moment to really just throw that aside, because what Bartimaeus shows us is a picture of salvation. See, the cloak is his past. And he is so certain, I love this, that Jesus is going to heal him, that what does he do? Just throws it away. And he runs to Jesus. The final thing we see in this text, and I want to just drill down on, is the fact that not only does he come to Jesus and follow Jesus, but notice what he does. He follows after Jesus when Jesus tells him to go home. Look at verse 51. Jesus answered him, "What do you want me to do for you?" Now, listen, I don't know if it happened this way, but if I'm Bartimaeus, I'm not doing this. I mean, just kind of to be honest with you, because, I mean, picture the scene here. So the disciples are kind of all around him. Jesus says, "Call this man to me." They part like the Red Sea. Picture it, okay? In my mind, this is what's happening, right? So they part like the Red Sea, and Bartimaeus is like, because nobody's helping him, right? So he's like walking over, and he gets before Jesus, and Jesus, like he always does, right? He bends down and he says, like, what do you want me to do for you? Now, that's not what I would do as a pastor, just being honest, right? Like, because like, if a guy comes down here, let's say, and he's blind, like after the service, immediately when he would get to the front, the pastor's here, what we would do is say, "Let me guess, you're blind, you want to sing," right? Or a person comes and they can't walk. Let me guess, you're lame, or you're injured and you want to walk. That's what we would do. But that's not what Jesus does. See, Jesus, I love this. Jesus knows what we need before we ask. But he still wants us to ask him. Isn't that cool about how God works? Like, he knows it, but he still wants, because here's the deal, watch this. It's a relationship. It's a relationship where he's basically building this trust and this understanding. And he says, "Jesus, Rabbi, I want to see." Now, I don't know if it happened this way, but just picture it. All eyes are on these two individuals, right? So Bartimaeus and Jesus. And so Bartimaeus is here, Jesus is there, and all eyes are on these two individuals. And follow this, that eye socket that's never seen the light of day begins to well up with a tear. I want you to follow this. Filled with sand and mud, the other eye socket that has not seen begins to fill up with a tear, and all of a sudden tears begin to stream down his cheeks. And for the first time, Bartimaeus opens his eyes, get this, and standing before him, the first thing he sees is the light of the world. I don't think you heard what I just said. You got to understand what, like standing before this guy, listen, the very thing he sees when he opens his eyes for the first time is the one who formed his eyes by hand, God, right? Like he opens his eyes and he sees Jesus, and Jesus is like, "Hey, go home. Your faith has made you well," right? Your faith, like, go tell everybody. And honestly, I would have done that. I mean, like, I'm probably not as spiritual as Bartimaeus, so I would have gone home. I would have gone to mom and dad who kicked me out of the house, you know, years before, and I would have said, "You know, now that I could see, I don't need you guys anyway," right? Like, I never did, and don't need you. That's what I might have done. Just full disclosure. I mean, probably would have done that. I definitely would have found all the girls who turned me down for the prom. You know, I mean, like, now that I can see, you're not that good looking anyway. I mean, that's what I would have maybe done, you know, probably. But that's not what he does. Like, look what the text says. It says, after he gets his sight, this is so interesting, immediately he could see, and he began to follow, look at verse 52, follow Jesus where? Can I say something to you with a lot of humility this evening? Listen to me. The reason you or someone you know has fallen away from the Lord possibly could mean that they never knew him to begin with. See, because what Bartimaeus shows us is when you truly see Jesus for who he is, you don't want to go back into the world. Like he sees him and he's like, where would I go? Now, that was not the case for me. I mean, I was raised in a very religious home. was born and raised in New Orleans, Louisiana, half Italian, very Roman Catholic. And anybody raised Catholic in here? Anybody Roman Catholic growing up? Yeah, so I was, and we weren't these Creaster Catholics, if you will, like Christmas and Easter only. Like, we went every week, right? And if we missed church on Sunday, I went to confession on Saturday and asked the priest to give me the peace of God so that I could go live like I wanted Monday through Saturday and do it all again, right? I mean, anybody with me? And I realized that doesn't just happen in the Catholic Church. That happens in the Baptist Church and the non-denominational. Like, it happens, right? But that's how I lived. I knew who Jesus was. You know, but for me, Jesus was like this dictator, out to get me, always chastising, this rule giver. I had to follow him, and if I got out of line, I was in trouble. Anybody saw a guy like this growing up? And I really didn't even think Jesus was real. Like, for me, I thought he was like the tooth fairy, right? Like, or Santa Claus. Like, when I needed him, I could rub the genie, and he would come, and then and when I didn't need it, I'd put him away. And so that's who I view Jesus as. I got a scholarship to play basketball at UNC Greensboro, which is a college in North Carolina. I was going to go play basketball there. And the girl I'm dating at the time was going to LSU. And so I was in high school. You know, I'm in love. I'm in high school, right? I'm going to stay together forever, right? That's what I'm thinking. And she's like, there's no way you can go that far away to college. You need to go close to home. And so I took the phone book and I opened it up and found William Carey College in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Has anybody heard of the college? Neither had I. I call the coach. I'm like, hey, can I try out for the team? And he's like, man, there's no way you can try out for the team. He's like, the team's already picked. But he hesitantly let me try out for the team. And back then, my role model was Michael Jordan. I mean, I had Michael Jordan posters on the wall. I had the ceiling with posters. I had the Wheaties with the Wheaties box. I had the gummy bears with the gummy bear. I clipped all the tongues off the show. I mean, I was be like Mike, although my name was Rob. I was Mike. I mean, I was going to be. And on that day, my mom said, she told me years later, she said, son, I'm just going to be honest with you. She said, you have never played that good prior to that day. And frankly, you have never played that good since that day. But on that day, you had Michael Jordan-like reflexes. And would you believe, by the providence of God, Coach Knight at William Carey calls me back 2 days later, and he said, you've got a scholarship to come play basketball at William Carey. And I took the offer 2 weeks into the semester. The girl I'm dating thinks I'm cheating on her, which I wasn't, but she breaks up with me. That's true. And so here I am as a Roman Catholic, and I figured out I'm on the campus of a Southern Baptist college. And I don't know if you know what that means. I mean, I was like, I'm the target of every evangelism class on campus, right? Who do we tell about Jesus? Let's tell the guy cruising through the red Mustang, blaring the unedited version of Tupac Shakur from his 10-inch subwoofers in the trunk, right? That was me. And I mean, I was lost, right? So I heard the gospel in 1995 by a guy who befriended me. He was the first guy who didn't try to conquer me as a project. I was like his friend, right? And so we had a lot in common. He was about 6'5", and so I think he was maybe one of the only guys brave enough back then to talk to me. And so he befriended me, and he said, Robby, listen, I want you to repeat a prayer, say after me this, because you don't want to go to hell, do you? And I said, no. And he said, so you've got to say, aha, at the right place, and you'll be saved. And I said, aha, and I thought I was saved, right? And this is 1995. Now, I want to tell you something, because I said a prayer like some of you probably have years before. And the reason I know that wasn't a true prayer of conversion and regeneration and salvation, this is how. Because I felt like I could have been a Christian for a week or two, right? But over time, I went back to the way I was. See, here's the thing. You can tell me today that you're a Christian. I may even believe you. But let me come live with you for a week, and I'll tell you what you believe. See, because here's what the Bible says. The Bible says you will know a tree by the what? By the fruit it bears. So write this down. Here's a principle I like to share with people. The root of one's heart is revealed through the fruit of one's life. Write that down. the root of our heart is revealed through the fruit of one's life, or the lack thereof. And if you were looking at Robby Gallaty's life back then, you would say there really wasn't any fruit, and you would have been right. I got out of college in 1998. Before I got out my junior year, I got into a network marketing company, kind of like Amway. Anybody familiar with this? And once you get in one, you're kind of a sucker for them all. I've been in a lot of them since then, you know, Excel, Essential Oils, and you know, I mean, a bunch of them, and so I kind of got into it. But back then, I learned the business of network marketing, and I was traveling around, thought I was going to be, you know, millionaire by the age of 25. It turned out to be like a pyramid scam, and so I got out of college in 1998. The whole business kind of went kaput, and I thought, you know what? I don't want to be in business anymore. I want to train Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And so here I was, 21. Yeah, that's what my mom said. So I'm 21, you know, I'm 6'6", 290 back then, and I'm like, what do you do with your life? I want to be in the UFC, right? Anybody familiar with the UFC? And so, yeah, and this was 98, so this is not what it is today, and so there was no money. In fact, the guys I was training with, the winning for winning a fight was less than the doctor bills to recover because nobody had insurance, which is really not real smart at the time, but that's what I wanted to do. And so I'm out at a club, restaurant one night, and I meet a guy named Gino, and Gino's like, hey man, listen, would you be interested? He comes up to me, he's like, would you be interested in being the head bouncer of my club downtown New Orleans in the middle of Mardi Gras? I'm like, let me get this straight. You're gonna pay me to fight? I'm in. I mean, right, I'm like, I'm in. Like that, this is what I've been waiting my whole life for. So I took that opportunity. 3 months, listen, It was the wildest 3 months of my life. You can imagine how difficult that was. And I realized I needed a career change. At one point, guy pulls a gun on me in the parking lot, says things I can't repeat now. And my roommate says, all right, I'll make a lateral move. We'll kind of move you around the company from bouncing to bartending, right? Seemed like a good opportunity at the time. And I started bartending. I was coming home from work November 22nd, 1999. This is where my whole life changed. If you've ever been to the city of New Orleans, there's this interstate called the High Rise, where New Orleans and Metairie kind of come together. And actually, they meet together, and you go up this big bridge. And an 18-wheeler, I was in his blind spot. And he came across two lanes of traffic, 65 miles an hour one afternoon. He latched up to the back end of my Mustang, slammed it into the guardrail at 65 miles an hour. My seatbelt locked, and my back torqued. And I herniated two discs in my neck and two discs in my back. I was 22 years old. And like anybody who gets in an accident of that caliber, I was legitimately in pain. And so I went to the doctor, and they said, man, it's amazing you made it home with as few injuries as you have, but you still probably will have to have surgery. We're going to send you home with four things. Watch this, 22 years old. Oxycontin, Valium, Soma, and Percocet. And, I mean, you know the story, right? Within 3 months, I'm addicted to drugs. And I was legitimately in pain, like a lot of people. I mean, for an accident or a back injury or a work accident, and you're taking them for pain. And now I've got a 30-day supply that I'm just kind of running through in 2 weeks, and so I have to find this way in the world to fulfill this insatiable desire to get high. And so a so-called friend in the city, his name was Jerome, he's like, hey, man, why are you fooling with pharmaceutical drugs? You can buy street drugs. You can buy heroin and cocaine. You can buy it in bulk. You can bag it, sell it, and make money, and kind of bankroll your addiction. And so it seemed like a great opportunity to take the business knowledge from the network marketing world, right, and bring it into the drug world, which for me at the time was a great blessing. Turned out to be the end of my life almost as I know it. And listen, in the beginning, times were really good. I mean, we started out, we had tons of money. I mean, I was trafficking everything from thousands of ecstasy pills a week to GHB, liquid, Special K, which is not a cereal, by the way, marijuana, heroin, and cocaine. And I'm not telling you this to impress you. I'm telling you this today to just impress upon you just how far the Lord has brought me from. Times were good. I mean, in the beginning, we had tons of money. We flew where we wanted. We did what we wanted. But then the addiction, as it always does, and you know, addiction always works this way. It always takes you further than you want to go. It keeps you there longer than you want to stay. And it always costs us more than we ever want to pay. I mean, that's what happens, right? We think we can manage it, but it always kind of gets out of control. And that's what happened to me. My parents, really close, I told you earlier, very close Italian family. I didn't know what to do. And so what I did is, when my dad wasn't looking, I took his credit card number and I memorized his credit card number. My dad had a big collision center. And over the course of a few months, I charged $15,000, almost bankrupted the family business. I've never forgotten the phone call from my mom. She called me that February. And she said, "Robby, your dad's found out about what you did. I'm disappointed in you. And your father's furious." She said, "Don't ever come to this house again." You know, and I was arrogant and prideful. And I said, "You know, Mom, I don't need you guys. I never did need you guys. I don't need you now." I hung the phone up. I took the little bit of money I had, and I blew it on drugs. And for the next 2.5 months of my life, I want to share with you, it was hell on earth. I lived without gas, electricity, and water for 2.5 months. The bill collectors called till they turned the phone off. And let me just say something to those in here, because in a group this size, I know that many of us in here today could say, "Pastor Robby, I'm dealing with something like that now." Maybe not you, but a family member or a friend or a loved one or a coworker. Like, we all, no one in here is immune from the ravages of addiction, right? We all know someone or are dealing with it now. Let me just share some, just kind of a sidebar that may help someone today. Here's the thing. My parents, particularly my mom's act of tough love, watch this, saved my life. See, because whenever you have a perpetual drug addiction, you always have either the result of an enabler, right? This is a loving family member like you who wants the best for the son, and you want the best for the daughter. You want to help the husband or the spouse, but in your help, you're actually hurting them. And if you keep enabling them, the only end is jails, institutions, or death. And so that's the end, right? And it was Mom's tough love that saved my life. And so here's the line I came up with. I want to share it with you. Write this down. If you keep being their savior, Jesus never can be. Like if you keep being their savior, Jesus never can. Why would they turn to Jesus when they have you, right? Mom and dad created a bottom for me where I said, "I don't want anything to do with you." Long story short, through a series of events, I begged my parents to take me back in, and my two unbelieving parents at the time showed the grace of God to me in an extraordinary way, took me back in, and within 1 week, I was in rehab in Tijuana, Mexico. Now, I know that's another sermon for another day, but that's where I went. Came back from rehab, relapsed again, long story short, and I remembered November 12, 2002, just 16 years ago. I've never read the Bible before, so I didn't even know Jesus before 16 years ago, but I was desperate, right? You ever been there? Like, I was so low where I thought, and listen, in my immature mind, I thought, I might as well give Jesus a try. Like I tried everything else. I had a $200 a day heroin and cocaine addiction. And what that means is every day I needed that to live in order to just make it by. And here's what I told the Lord. I said, "Jesus, if you're real, I knew I was a sinner. I knew if I died, I'd go to hell. I knew that. I lost 8 friends through drug and alcohol-related deaths. 6 went to prison. And I was asking the Lord to save me in this moment." And here's what I told him. I said, "If you're real," that's what I said, "I'm going to go after you, Jesus, with the same intensity I did to get high." If you know anything about an addiction, you never get in the way of an addict trying to get high, right? And I want to share with you, November 12, 2002, I had a Paul-like 24-hour radical experience with Christ. Did I know the right prayer to pray? No. Did I know all of the Old and New Testament? No. Watch this. I took as much faith I had and put it in as much of Jesus as I knew, and God radically saved me. And here's what I want you to see today. You may say, "Well, my life's not like your life. Like I don't have a drug addiction, or I don't have a heroin addiction, I don't have a past like you. Brother or sister, with all due respect, you have the same problem. It's a sin problem, right? And the longer you kind of keep that at bay, the longer you're going to be perpetually in a life of sin and separation from God. See, the key to Bartimaeus, and this is what I want to give you an opportunity today to really just get right with the Lord. The key to Bartimaeus is he did three things, and I want you to examine your own situation. Number one, he understood his situation. Like, he knew exactly who he was, and he knew exactly who God was. Number two, he surrendered his life to Christ. What he did is he took the significance of the cloak, which was a picture of his former life, and he said, I'm throwing that away, and I'm coming to God. I want to ask you, what is the cloak in your life? Think about it now. Just think about it. What is the cloak? What's that one consistent, persistent thing in your life that's holding you back from going all in for God? And then finally, what is it going to take for you to follow Jesus completely? I want you to just bow your head for just a moment as we close. And I just want to pray over you tonight. If you're at one of our campuses here, and I just want you to bow your head for just a moment. You're watching online. I just want you to bow your head for just a moment. Put your Bible aside. Put your notes aside. No one looking around but me. I just want to pray for you personally, individually. I want you to really take a stand tonight. I want you to put a spiritual marker down. I want this to be a significant time of your life. And so here's what I want to do. I'm going to pray. I don't want anyone looking at me. But if you're here today and you're saying, Pastor, that's me. I don't know Jesus, but I want to know Jesus like you say you know Jesus. And I'm asking God to take away some things in my life like he's taken away for you. Would you just be so bold right where you are and just without saying a word? You don't have to come. You don't have to step forward. You just slip your hand up right where you are. And you're just saying, Pastor, pray for me. And I just want to pray from someone who's been there and been the recipient of grace. I want to pray God's grace to be upon your life. So would you just slip your hand? Thank you. Anyone else? Pastor Robby? Thank you, brother. Pastor, just pray for me. Thank you. Anyone else? Any hands all over? Anyone in the back? Pastor, pray for me. Thank you, brother. You're at one of our campuses. Pray for me, Pastor Robby. Thank you. Thank you. I want to know Jesus. Father, I thank you so much that you give sight to the blind and that you come looking for us when we are not even looking for you, and you stop before us when we cry out to you. And God, I pray tonight for the hands that have been raised, and I pray today for those even here with us who are saying, I need Jesus. I need to be set free from sin. I need to be set free from addiction. I need to be set free from myself. I need to be set free from anything that will get in the way of going all in for you. And so, God, I pray that you would fill them with your Spirit in such a way that not only do you give them a place in heaven, which is great, but you give them the power of the Holy Spirit to live today, to experience victory and joy, and to walk in newness of life. For your glory and for your namesake, we ask it in the only name we know how. And that is the strong and powerful name of Jesus Christ. And everyone said, amen.